Good evening. Thank you for joining us for High School 101. I'm going to open with a word of prayer and then kind of give a quick overview and talk about a couple things and then turn it over to a couple of our speakers this evening. But let me open with a word of prayer. Dear God, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for the opportunity we have to just plan and look at what's in store. We thank you for the opportunity as a school to work with these families and to partner with these parents to mold our students into what you have in store for them. And so our goal is always to help them determine your will and then pursue it. And so just help us as we come alongside these parents and prepare them for high school, just to give them a little glimpse of what's coming so that they can be ready for this process. So we just thank you for your blessing, for the opportunity we have to do this through serving you and to be an overtly Christian school. And so we just ask for your continued blessing, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So thank you for coming out this evening. How many of you, this is the first high schooler that you're going to have next school year? Raise your hand if this is your first high schooler. Okay. How many of you, this is going to be your last? Yeah, so that's the excited group who knows kind of what's in store. Is there anybody where that's the same? You raised your hand for both? So we do have a couple singletons in here. So the goal for this evening is to stop just short of overwhelming you. So that's our goal. We're going to try and provide you a lot of broad information with the goal of setting you up for high school. As a parent, primarily, as a student as well, you're going to hear some student perspectives from Mr. Newell. But our goal is just to give you an outline of what's coming. And so you're going to hear from several different people, because high school is where opportunities really start to open up. Whether it's in clubs or athletics or academics with electives, there's lots more opportunity that students have. Second only really to their transition to college, where everything kind of floods open. And so we want to give you glimpses of some of the things that are in store for your students so that you can begin having conversations about what direction do they want to head. Or more importantly, what direction does God want them to head? We try and focus on that as in high school, is instead of asking the question, well, what do you want to do? Trying to shift that question to asking, well, what do you feel like God wants you to do? And that doesn't come naturally. I talk with our seniors especially, and I get caught up in the trap of, well, where do you want to go to college? When really the question should be, where do you think God wants you to go to college? Because it just gets them in the framework of involving God in their decision making. And so you're going to hear from an overview of some impressions from ninth graders from Mr. Newell. You're going to hear about athletics from Coach Davis, fine arts from Mr. Kastner, a brand new advanced placement opportunity, which is kind of the elite of the elite academically, from Ms. Lyon. And then Mr. Robertson is going to kind of overwhelm you at the end with a lot of details. So he's hitting a lot of academics, some thinking about college. It's not too early to start that process. And so we're just excited about the chance to start this process as we move forward. So two things that I want to talk about that are going to be brand new for us this year. And so we're in the beginning stages of putting together information and doing some new hires. But one of the things that you've heard about are what we're calling the academies at Hebron Christian. And so the academies is an opportunity for us as a school to help students start to focus in some key areas where we've identified our students are really interested in these areas, and we need to prepare them for what's to come after high school. And so we've got four different academies that we're introducing: the Academy of Leadership, of Science and Innovation, of Fine Arts, and Classical Studies. Some of these really are geared to just enhance some of the really good things that we're already doing. The best example is probably our Academy of Fine Arts. We have a great fine arts program that some of you have already experienced in middle school. And in high school, we just step it up another notch. But we're looking at how can we keep expanding those opportunities? How can we keep using the gifts and talents that our students have? Because we've got some incredibly gifted students here, and that's what we want to pursue. We've got other areas like leadership and classical studies where we're trying to provide more opportunities. In addition to what we have, we're looking to really emphasize some business courses because a lot of our students have talked about wanting to go into business or into marketing or areas like that. And so we're looking for opportunities. And then science and innovation is really where we're taking a big step of faith and a leap forward, not just a little step. We're going to be working on a big maker space, a STEM lab. And so there's some opportunities to challenge our students that are really into the areas of STEM. And so we're excited about those courses. Now, honestly, as freshmen, it's not going to impact them quite as much because they're just getting their feet wet in high school. The goal of freshman year is to start discovering where their interests are. And so we're going to be talking about electives. The other disadvantage to freshmen is everybody else gets to pick first. Seniors get first choice, then juniors, then sophomores. And so, but our goal is to provide those opportunities for freshmen so that they can see, well, I'm going to give this a try. Now, the other component that we're adding next school year is called the J term. J stands for January. It just sounds cooler to say J term instead of January term. But it's an opportunity for us to sort of pause in between semesters. It actually breaks our semesters into exactly identical number of days. Just worked out that way. But when we get back from Christmas break next January, students will have an 8-day J term where they'll have a morning class and an afternoon class. Now, the morning class for freshmen, we're just going to call it freshman seminar. And that's really where we're going to dig in with freshmen and focus on, okay, where are you gifted? What do you want to pursue? They're going to outline a path for high school during that J term because they're going to be really exposed to all four academies. They're going to have times where they're going to be have presentations by the leader of each academy. They're going to hear about some of the electives, both in J term and during the school year. And they're going to start charting, well, what do I think I want to do my sophomore, junior, senior year? And which academy do I really want to push? And then what level do I want to pursue in that academy? Because there will be different levels. In the afternoon, they'll have the opportunity to pick from a bunch of different J term electives. And a lot of those will be designed just for freshmen because all freshmen will be taking classes in the morning. So we're going to need probably 6 to 8 additional electives in the afternoon just for our freshmen. And so that'll be geared for them so that they can, again, pick an area that they want to investigate. And so we're excited about both of these opportunities that we have to expand our offerings in high school and really set our students up so that they can start pursuing and answering the question, well, what did God create me for? When I go to college, I look at it with my daughters. When they go to college, I don't want them to have my experience is, well, what do I major in? Well, I like math, but what are you going to do with a math degree? I had no clue. Like, God knew. He knew I was going to become a math teacher someday, but I didn't think there was a chance that I would be a math teacher. And so, honestly, I just kept doing it for 4 years because my dad said if I wanted to go a fifth year, I could pay for it. And I wasn't about to pay for it. So that's why I got a math degree. I would like for my daughters to have a little bit more intentionality behind their college degree, but I know that God is in it. And so I want them to become more aware of it when they're in high school. And that's our goal for your students as well. So that's just a few of our major areas of emphasis for next school year. I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Newell, and he's going to talk with you a little bit about what freshmen say freshman year is like.
Thank you. My name is Carter Newell, and I've had the privilege of teaching freshmen for the last 15 years here at Hebron. And it dawned on me probably 5-6 years ago that as people ask me about teaching freshmen, characteristics about freshman students, I realized I was relying quite a bit on anecdotal examples, which are fine, but since Mr. Annett's arrived, he's challenged us to think more data-driven, because he's a math guy. And so I thought, you know what, I think I need to get some good data about the freshmen and what they think about their freshman year, because that may be helpful to rising freshmen. And so for the last 5 or 6 years or so, I've been doing that. Now, I did not do one this year. I'm hoping that the experiences of starting school in a pandemic is an anomaly, I pray. Because I'm hoping that's not a repetitive thing. So the examples I'm going to give you with the questions and then the general responses are going to be based on last year's statistics. And the first graphic is I just wanted to find out what they thought was great about the freshman year. Now, I should note, and this is really poor on my behalf, so I'm sure Coach Johnson would probably get after me for how I'm using this particular statistical graph. The size of the graph does not indicate the larger number of responses. If it was, if that were true, I really should have put homecoming in there, because homecoming is a traditional strong answer, and I get usually most responses that's what they were most excited about, the homecoming dance, the football game, and those kinds of things. But the other things also were mentioned frequently, and I'm hoping, but I don't know, that perhaps what Mr. Annett just shared about the increased opportunities in J-term and also in the different academies might also be represented, who knows, in the future about having, instead of the graphic, more freedom, perhaps maybe more opportunities might be there as well. The next question that I asked was, what's been most difficult to adjust to? Because that's important. If you know what you're getting into, so you have some expectation. By far, the homework load was listed as the top one. So that is, if you're in this room and you're looking forward to next year, keep in mind that time management is going to be really important. And how you're going to manage being involved in what you're currently involved in or maybe even expanded along with your workload. And The more years you're in high school, the better you're able to handle sort of how the process goes each year with the activities you're involved in. Obviously, preparing for quizzes and tests and having more of them. And then biology. Now, all sciences are different because they require a little bit of different skills. If you think of, if you can recall from your high school parents, you know that physics and chemistry involve a little bit more math. But biology, there's a lot of terminology there, and you have to know the terms and how things work together. And that can be a lot added into what they're currently doing. So that typically is a challenge class. I've had enough children through the school and currently have now that I sort of know in high school, like, at which grade level is the most challenging class, because I warn my children to be prepared. Not to skip that class, but to be prepared for the challenge, which sometimes they're excited about and sometimes they're not. I wanted to know about time management, how much time they were spending. This particular graph shows you a little bit about homework on a weeknight. I have found that usually the bulk of responses are usually within an hour, but we do have some students who are very rigorous about making sure everything is done and thorough, and that's going to take longer. You know your children and students, you know yourself, so you're going to have to figure out what takes more time. And my suggestion was get to the more difficult things first if you can, and then as you get more tired, it's a little bit easier to maybe to do things that don't require such a taxation on your mental abilities. What is the most helpful method of finding out what homework or quizzes you have do from day to day? So I just asked my class this verbally as well as in this particular question, and I found that they like a variety of methods. They still want to hear it from me. They still want to see it on the board even if they don't write it down, and they want to see it in the hub. Parents typically like to see the hub because that's your access, if you will, to the class and information. But I still have students who will either sit down and write it down, who want me to repeat it, or want to see it on the hub, or all three. And again, that's particular to the student about the best way that they understand what's due, when, and their responsibilities. This next slide had to do with the kind of homework. The bulk of the homework is usually preparing for quizzes and tests. And of course, keeping up with reading and language arts for book reports. Next, when and where did you do your homework? I was curious as to how this was going to come out, because I hear students all the time who don't think that I hear them in their casual conversations about their homework. And I just smirk to myself, because I have children as well, and some responses are typical. But what I found interesting is you'll have to keep some of this image in your mind before we go to the next one, is the number of students that do homework throughout the day. Now, as a teacher, I'm like, I understand that. I was a student. And yet at the same time, if that means also that they're doing other work in a class that they need to be paying attention, that can be difficult. So again, this goes back to time management, trying to figure out when to study and how to prepare for which classes and to be ready for those. I'm really glad that number six was low. I rarely do homework. I hope that's true when they were all doing this. But yes, that's good that that's a rarity. Now, if you look at this, this is where I find the last graphic in this one interesting. So if you look at the third one down, pay attention in class. So if you're doing somebody else's homework in class, then paying attention is going to be a little difficult at the same time. Now, there are some people who are very good at multitasking, but I find that a rarity among 15-year-olds. But it's possible. Sometimes it's more possible than perhaps my sophomore son picking up the sock 2 inches and putting it in the laundry basket, which seems to be an improbability in science to be able to do that. But you can see there, this is their recommendations from the students, going to help sessions, paying attention in class, not giving up and being productive with your time. There are times when when I think of fine arts, I've had children in fine arts, during the play weeks, there's going to be quite a bit of extra practices leading up to various athletic events and so forth. There may be more time. And so just not giving up. There are enough grades. Teachers give enough grades so that one individual grade should not do any student in. We have a variety of ways to assess. And that concludes my portion. And so now I'm going to have our athletic director, Taylor Davis, come on up and talk about athletics.
All right, like Mr. Carter said, my name is Taylor Davis. I'm the director of athletics here at Hebron. This is my 10th year and 8th year as the athletic director. And like previously shared by Mr. Carter, one thing that I can kind of share when your child goes into ninth grade next year is the work ethic and the expectation level. So I've had the privilege of watching your kids if they've been at Hebron playing sports. And at the middle school level, it is good. It is a commitment. But as they move and graduate to high school, that commitment level becomes pretty drastic. So to date, we have won 6 GHSA state championships. We have had 8 state runner-ups, 33 region or area championships, and last year our athletic program finished 5th in overall. So that kind of gives a snapshot of where we currently are at athletically and the direction that we're headed. So from a performance standpoint, we've excelled, but also from a participation standpoint, and I know many of you in this room tonight do participate in athletics. Last year, we had close to 78% of our middle school participate in athletics. Last year, we also had 75% of our high school athletes participate. And this year, we're trending to have a much higher percentage from middle school and high school. We're trending to actually have a low 80%, which is one of the best years we've ever had as a school. We've also grown to accommodate a little bit more than 55 sports teams. And the latest teams that Hebron has added is esports and bass fishing, both of which were added this past year. And it's just another unique way to be able to compete for your school and be recognized by the GHSA, and also an opportunity that's a little bit outside the norm, and both of which have had a great time so far this year. Another area we have grown is our athletic facilities. Many of you guys have seen that over the last 4 years, we've added a turf field, 8-lane track, the Hebron Center, new practice fields for athletics, the new softball field, and a brand new press box, which I was in just earlier today over at the baseball field. So I shared these exciting things in our athletic program to simply say this: there is not a better time to be a Hebron Lion than this. And as we look to next year, I encourage your son or daughter to jump in, try a sport for the first time, or continue that work ethic and commitment level as you guys enter next year. Speaking of next year, we want to look at the calendar, because I know this is a topic of conversation as you guys enter spring and the summer. So here in just a few weeks, if not months, we are looking for the fall of 21 season, which is kind of hard to imagine to think about next year, but it is upon us. And so please be on the lookout for a few different parent meetings and also tryouts. So our competition cheerleading, they will have tryouts sometime in mid-March. Our volleyball and softball programs will have tryouts mid-May. Our cross country will have their parent meeting mid-May, and we will have football tryouts, which is kind of spring practice. That will be a 10-day window in the month of May, followed by a spring game with Cherokee Bluff. That would be on May 14th. As we go into late spring, I encourage you guys, in the past we've had a one sports physical night. I hope this year we will have that opportunity. I'm not quite sure with COVID this year, but it's my hope and plan to do what we have done in the past, which we have been in the Lions Arena, and we normally do between 150 and 180 kids, and that way you can get your sports physical and be done with it the entire year, which will make it an entire calendar year. Also, talking about an expectation with next year, the weight training program that we've had here at Hebron has grown drastically. I was doing some research when I looked probably 6-7 years ago. We had low 20s between boys and girls at high school. We hit 170 student athletes last year in the weight program. And so I kind of shared on the front end of our success, and that is directly correlated with the work ethic that has been put in the weight room. So as you go into next year, I know, you know, as a rising ninth grader, it's a high commitment, but we do encourage our student athletes to join weight training. We do make that a little bit easier because I know electives are at a premium. We have added we've added a health and PE class over the summer. And so you have an opportunity to take a 2-week course here during the summer to take the health and PE off the course load. And so during the school year, in your ninth grade year, you have an extra elective open for weight training. Finally, we do have 25 sports programs in the summer that we offer camps. So if you're thinking that, you know what, I do want to try to get into tennis or football or basketball or baseball, we have 25 camps that we offer. And so I'd highly suggest, they will be posted on our website in the weeks to come. Take a look, and if you're interested in a new sport or joining a sport, be a great opportunity to try that. So as you can see, we have a lot of opportunity. And I, for one, I'm excited about next year. I'm excited about this eighth grade class moving to high school. And if you have any specific questions that may relate to athletics, just feel free to reach out to me, and I can put you in contact with the head coach. And I know they're excited to work with you. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Mr. Kastner, who will be talking about the Fine Arts Program.
Good evening. My name is Chris Kastner. This is year, I don't know, 9, maybe, sorry. 15 total, though, so 9 here. Just to piggyback before I forget, because I've been known to forget things, on what Taylor Davis just mentioned about the weight training and PE option over the summer. As ninth graders it does become quite difficult or challenging, if you will, to kind of fit everything into your day. So in fine arts, we've kind of figured out, hey, if we can recommend that you guys take PE and health over the summer, it frees up an elective for you. And that means you aren't then forced to choose between a fine art and an athletic, or a fine art and something else. So really consider the PE health over the summer. If that's you and you're like, man, I really want to do the weight training, but I really like being in chorus, or I really like want to do weight training, but I really like drama or band or something. Really, really consider doing that over the summer if you have the time. How long did you say? 2 weeks? 2 weeks. So I would strongly encourage it. And that way it gives you that freedom to make that choice your ninth grade year. So hopefully when you walked in, you got a sheet of paper with a whole lot of words on it. I'm not going to read that to you. I know you're all very pleased to hear that. I do just want to point out a few things. When it comes to fine arts, we try to, and this kind of goes along with the academies, we try to offer as many different things as possible. So I know myself, I teach symphonic high school band, so that's 9th through 12th grade. I also teach, we have marching band after schools. I do praise band, which is the band that performs at and leads worship for all of our chapel events. Which, by the way, if you're interested in that, we're going to have auditions in the next month or so. So if you play guitar, you sing, play piano, if you play drums, and I don't know about it yet, you and I need to meet. But I'm being serious. So, yes, if that's you and you feel led to, you want to try and lead your peers in worship, lead your teachers and whatnot in worship, be on the lookout for that. That'll be in the Roar. We have a women's ensemble, men's ensemble, taught by Mr. Sass, an amazing chorus teacher. They do performances by themselves and together. Miss Glover, what can I say about Miss Glover? She is amazing. She is our drama teacher here, and she teaches middle school drama, high school drama. She does all the after-school productions, both middle school and high school. Mrs. Smith, those of you that know her, seventh grade teacher here, she also teaches dance. She does a middle school dance class and a high school dance class. Hopefully in the near future we'll be able to offer a few more dance classes, perhaps with some more variety. As you guys get older, and this kind of ties into what Ms. Lyons is going to talk about in the AP classes, we do offer, a couple years ago we started offering AP music theory. For those of you that have an interest in that, analyzing chords and music structure and things like that, it is an AP course and will count towards college credit and things like that. So Mr. Sass has taught that the past number of years, but it's, you know, I could teach it too if needed. So and when it comes to art, all the possibilities, 2D, 3D, graphic design, if you like using computers. We just upgraded our Mac Lab to the newest versions of all the iMac desktops, and the graphic design stuff here is really quite amazing. Photography is kind of a newer class that we started a few years ago with Mr. Cameron. It's now being taught by Mr. Lacey, and they do all kinds of stuff, pictures with phones and lighting and like legit cameras. They you randomly just kind of see them all throughout campus taking random pictures. So I know they come in the band room quite often just to take pictures of stuff, and I'm like, sure, go ahead. Yearbook, if you're into that, kind of like scrapbooking, but on a really big scale. And you get to use the computer, so this graphic design stuff. Taught by Mrs. Mruck. So she's been doing that a number of years, as long as she's been here, and our yearbooks, I'm sure you guys are aware, are pretty awesome. So that is that. The digital video technology is kind of new to us. Mr. Reed actually teaches that, and It's the class that basically produces the Taylor Talk videos that you guys see just about every week. So they are running the behind the scenes. They do the lighting, they do the audio, they do the film, they do the whole thing. And Mr. Reed kind of just supervises, and then they collaborate to put it all together on a weekly basis. So just kind of the rundown there. The last thing that I just want to point out, we do a fine arts trip. This year it was canceled due to COVID, but past number of years it's been to Disney World, and hopefully we'll kind of return to somewhat of a normal trip schedule next year. It doesn't have to be Disney World. We've not really talked about going anywhere else, but we like to have fun. They do workshops and all sorts of things, performances down there, and then get to spend some time at the park. So if you're into any of that stuff, or if you have questions, feel free to contact Mr. Rob or myself, and we'll be happy to answer anything that you might need. So up next is Miss Lyon.
I get to recycle, so, you know, you possibly could have me next year, and then again, 11th grade. So if you liked me, I guess that's a good thing. If you didn't like me, that's your living nightmare, so, you know. So I'm really excited about getting to teach AP Human Geography here. I actually taught it at Peachtree Ridge before I got hired here, with the AP United States History course. But it's probably one of my favorite things I've ever taught. And I'm super excited I get to do it from a biblical perspective, because obviously you can't talk about Jesus in public school. You might get arrested. So I'm really excited that they're letting me teach this, and it is going to be a pretty in-depth global perspective of how the world works, and I think it pairs very well with any of your students that do anything in the missionary field. It will give them a really good education on what the world looks like and kind of how it operates. So without further ado, why take AP Human Geography? All right, well, one thing is a lot of the more, competitive universities, you have to have AP hours to get into the university. In fact, that's something your kids might want to really consider looking at over the summer, is kind of making a list of how many AP hours, if they want to go to Georgia or Clemson, or if they don't, maybe they don't want to go to a bigger school and they want to go to a smaller school, that's great. But many of these competitive universities, you do have to have a certain amount of AP hours. So just keep that in your back of your mind. So there's two things. When you take an AP class, they look at the grade, obviously, and then in May you take an AP exam. What they get on the exam, 3 is passing, it's out of a score, 1 to 5, 3 is passing, is what will give them college credit. So it saves you saves them time and saves you guys money. Another thing is that Hebron actually does is they gain a point to their GPA for taking an AP level class. All right, so is your child ready for AP? That's the question of the day, right? Not everybody's ready, but if your child wants to be challenged and they want to get onto that AP track moving forward to AP World History, AP U.S. History, and all the other APs, I highly recommend you taking it. It's a great stepping stone, and it really is beneficial. When we were at Peachtree Ridge, we looked at a bunch of data about students and their pass rates compared in AP World compared to kids that did not take AP Human. And it was overwhelmingly over 80% kids did much better, 4s and 5s on the AP exam versus kids who did not take AP Human Geography. However, also you guys got to understand this is a college level course. Now, I don't want to scare you. I'm not going to load your kid down with hours and hours of homework every night. I'm not going to do that. But there will be reading and, learning and reviewing concepts is really highly recommended every night. But so just keep in mind that this is a college level course. Another thing I did want to make a mention of is, that this is a more, but there is some more mature material involved when taking AP Human Geography. Know that I am a parent, and I am not going to just let anything fly in class. There is a filter here, but we will be talking things, you know, like genocide and war violence, you know, when we talk about the breakup of Yugoslavia, or we talk about Sudan, things like that, you know, violence between religions, things like that, and talking about population, looking at the one-child policy, obviously the two-child policy today. What are those things? Why did they implement those things? How did they affect their population? You know, now they're having a major problem because they have too many men and not enough women. So things like that we'll be exploring. So there is kind of a more mature level of knowledge and conversation that will occur with this class. So just keep that back in the back of your minds as well. All right. So I just wanted to give you guys a little bit of example with a AP question, a test question, multiple choice versus like a regular geography type question. And what is the difference? Well, basically, it's not good enough just to know the material. You actually have to apply the material in a critical thinking kind of way. So an example of that is on, you have the AP style question where they have to know all those answers, but being able to apply it in such a fashion. It's not just a regurgitation type of thing, which you see on the right-hand side. So that's kind of the different levels of an AP style question versus just a regular honors level type question. These tests are difficult, but I promise you we have lots of projects and stuff throughout the year to alleviate any test grades that might look necessarily not too good. And I also do the square root curve as well, and you guys can ask me questions afterwards about all that. So another component of the AP Human class is doing free response questions. And when they get to AP World, they'll actually have free response questions. We call them SAQs at that level. They'll do a document-based essay and an LEQ, which is a long essay question. So the writing exponentially increases as the APs go up, okay? But in AP Human, they learn how to do the free response portion of it. And this is an example of what those types of questions look like. And typically it's 35 questions, multiple choice, and then your free response, you usually get two on a test. So I just kind of wanted to give you guys a little glimpse into AP Human Geography. I'm really excited about teaching it. And if you guys have any questions, I'll hang around and answer any questions I best can to my ability. And I'll give it now to Harry.
And we are excited about the AP Human Geography class. It's our first time we've ever offered an AP class to ninth grade or as a whole. And but we also want to realize, since this is a college-level class, we will have certain standards to get into the class based on, like, teacher recommendations, PSAT results, grades, things like that. But we'll talk more about shortly about how we look at recommending people for classes in just a moment. So I'm here to talk about academics. It's a major part of high school, and so that's what I want to talk about. And what I've done is I've divided this up into five things to know about academics in high school. And I do want to mention this. You got a high school 101 newsletter. A lot of the information I'm going to give you right now is in there, so don't feel like you have to take a lot of notes and all that. A lot of that will be in there. I will also mention this. We are videotaping this, and we're going to put this up onto our site as well so that you can review if you forget some things and things like that here. So we'll have all that information for you here. But let's talk about the five things that I think are important when you look ahead for high school. Number one, I want to give you some guidelines for success in high school. And these are things that you should know and can do as you go into ninth grade that will help you be successful academically. So students, I really encourage you, as you look ahead for high school, that you do these things, okay? And you will notice that some of these things are very similar to what Mr. Newell mentioned when he did the survey results. These are ninth graders who looked back and said, I wish I had done these things. So some things that I think you can do to get the most out of high school. Number one, get started right. From the beginning, make right choices to give your best. from the beginning, keeping up with your homework completely, from the beginning, keeping up with all of your assignments. The way you start as a ninth grader is going to be very critical to how you are in high school. So it's important that you start right. Number two, get organized. That's, you know, as you start high school, take good notes. Use an agenda or a plan or some way to stay organized and to plan ahead. Study every day. Don't just wait, you know, to the last minute and work ahead. Get connected. Find a good study partner, somebody who you can study with that can help you be better in that class. Find a good peer tutor if you need to. As was mentioned, some classes are harder than others, so it's good to have someone to help you prepare for that. And then know when the teachers are giving help classes. Sometimes it's good, even when you're not really that far behind, but that you can get the extra help from that teacher. Getting involved is so important in high school. I encourage you to join a club. I encourage you to play a sport. I encourage you to participate in all the different things that you can do there. Getting involved is very important. And then lastly, get going. Right now, as going into ninth grade, start thinking ahead about college and where you might want to go to college. And also even thinking about what you might want to do for career. Thinking about these things early on will just help you be that much more successful. So talking about getting involved, let's look specifically at some of the ways you can get involved. There are many clubs to join when you move into high school. Now, I know this year has kind of been a little bit different with COVID. We haven't maybe met as many times, but many of our clubs do meet, and they meet during lunch. They might meet in the morning before school, sometimes even after school. Clubs are a great thing to show on your resume. Clubs can help you develop your interests in certain areas. They can strengthen your leadership skills, and they give you opportunities for community service and other things like that. Colleges like to see involvement, so this is a good thing to be doing, to be thinking ahead for college. They like to see your involvement. They like to see leadership. They like to see community service. So all of those things will benefit you as you look ahead. And know that certain clubs have academic service and leadership requirements to get in. So start doing those things now so that that will help you for the future. Talking about community service, we do encourage our high school students to serve in the community and around the school, and it will help you become a more well-rounded person. It will, again, as I mentioned before, it will look good on a college resume, and hopefully will also demonstrate the love of Christ to others around us. We like to recognize our students here at HCA when they have documented 25 or more community service hours. At the end of the year, we have an awards program, and we recognize those students who have done community service. So we encourage you, even as eighth graders, to do that, but even more so as you start high school. We have a program called Mobile Serve, which is on the hub, and you should be able to see it there, and that's a good way to actually document your community service. Another thing I'm just going to mention, our seniors, as they graduate, when seniors have 200 or more community service hours over all of high school, they will earn an honor cord as well. So it's something maybe to be thinking ahead for as well. Let's move on to the second thing. So we've looked at some guidelines to be successful. Now let's look about academics in our high school with diploma options, the course requirements, and how credits work in high school. First of all, our diploma options. We offer three diploma options at Hebron Christian Academy. We have college prep with distinction, we have college prep, and we have career prep. Now, the first two are the most common, so those are the ones I'm going to really spend some time on. First of all, college prep with distinction. This is actually the most popular diploma option that our students have. It has four main criteria. First of all, we look at the student's core GPA. If they graduate with at least a 3.0 core GPA, then they are eligible for the college prep with distinction. They also have to have a minimum of 27 credits by the time they graduate. They have to have at least four honors classes or above throughout high school. And then they have to have at least 3 years of foreign language. So those are the four main criteria that we have for the college prep distinction diploma. Our college prep diploma, the students have to have at least a C average. They have to have at least 26 credits 2 years of a foreign language, but no honors requirements here. So those are the two main ones that we deal with for our diploma options. We keep talking about credits, so I want to make sure you understand credits. So how do credits work? Well, each semester of a class, a student will earn a half of a credit. A full-year course will earn a full credit. So if a student takes 7 full-year classes, they'll earn 7 credits each year of high school. It's also important to know that in high school, each semester of a class stands alone. There's no yearly grade like there is in middle school. Okay, so if a student were to fail a first semester class, the second semester can't bring it up. Each semester stands on its own, so they would have to make up that one semester. So in high school, each semester is on its own. I do want to talk about eighth grade high school credit. There are some classes that students will be receiving high school credit from eighth grade. We give high school credit for Algebra 1, for Spanish 1, and for Latin 1. These classes will show on your transcript for high school credit. But starting this year, we are going to be following what most public schools are doing right now. We will not be putting the grades for the eighth grade classes on the transcript, just the credits. So what it will show on the transcript is Algebra 1 or Honors Algebra 1 or Accelerated Algebra 1, and it will have a P next to it to say that they passed it, okay? And this is how most schools are doing it, because a lot of Hope Scholarship colleges are not calculating the eighth grade classes into their GPA. So we're just showing that they took the class and they received credit for it. So let's talk about the different course levels and how they are different. We have 4 different levels of classes here. First of all, we have college prep classes. These are our standard classes that prepare students for college level work. So every student that goes through here will be getting being prepared for college level work. The next level is honors and accelerated classes. These will move at a faster pace of instruction. They'll be more in depth in their coverage of material, and sometimes more work will be required in the class. Let me tell you a little bit example of the difference between honors and college prep classes. For example, an honors level language arts class may require an extra book to be read in the summer and an extra book to be read during the school year. An honors class also may also have more weight added to the test average than what a college prep class. For example, a college prep class might be 50% for the test average, whereas in an honors class it could be 60%. So there are differences between honors and accelerated, not just with the pace, but how they're graded as well. And then let's talk about AP and dual enrollment classes. These are actually college level classes. They're extremely demanding, very writing intensive, and only for the most highly motivated students. So we do look at them in a higher way, and especially in our recommendations of students going into that. I'd like to now look at each of the subject levels and just talk about what's required in each one of the departments. First of all, in English. In English, 4 credits are required for graduation. In 9th and 10th grade, we have a regular and honors level. And then in 11th and 12th grade, we offer regular honors, dual enrollment, and advanced placement classes. So this shows you, if you see on the slide, all the different classes we offer. I also put out that 4-year plan for you to look at so you could kind of see what's offered in the different subject levels. In math, we have 2 general tracks based on decisions going into 9th grade. Track 1 will start with Math 1 and then go into Geometry, Algebra 2, and a senior math. Track 2 will start with Geometry, then go to Algebra 2, Precalculus, and a senior math. And you can see the senior maths listed there. By the way, Geometry, Algebra 2, and Precalculus all have a college prep level, an honors level, and an accelerated level. In science, you can see the classes that we offer here. We have 4 credits that are required for graduation. And again, in 9th and 10th grade, we have a regular and honors level classes for the science. And then in 11th and 12th grade, we offer a regular honors and an AP level. In social studies, 4 credits are required for that for graduation at Hebron. In 9th and 10th grade, we have regular honors and AP level now with the new AP Human Geography added. And then in 11th and 12th grade, we offer regular honors, dual enrollment, and advanced placement classes. You can see our Bible classes, basically what we require for Bible, one credit for each year of attendance. So if somebody came in 10th grade, we wouldn't make them go back and take a credit from 9th grade, but for each year you're here, we want you to have a full credit of Bible. Foreign language, we offer Spanish and Latin. Spanish, we have 5 levels. They are college prep and honors, and then when you get to Spanish 3, 4, and 5, they can be dual enrollment. And then Latin, we have college prep and honors, and then when you get to Latin 3 and 4, that can also be dual enrollment to get college credit. As was mentioned by several people, we do require physical education and health for high school, most usually in the 9th grade. Many students choose to do it in the summer. We actually will have a June session of it and a July session of it, and we'll get those dates out to you shortly. But if you decide not to do it in the summer, it should be something that we'll put in the fall and the spring semesters. And then we are trying to offer a lot more electives. We require 3 or 4 electives for our graduation. We'll have some visual arts electives that Mr. Kastner has mentioned about. We'll have some music electives. Some of them will require tryouts. We also will have some performing arts electives. And then if you can see up on the screen, we'll also offer some other electives. And some of those would be like business electives, STEM electives, computer electives, and so forth. So we're hoping to offer some of those. We're not for sure which ones exactly we're offering until we finish our hiring. So a sample course selection for a 9th grader. Again, a student will have 9, in 9th grade they'll have 7 classes. They'll have a language arts class, they'll have a math class, a science class, they'll have Western Civ, which will be their Bible and social studies. They'll have a foreign language. If they choose to do PE and health in the fall, then they'll have that, and then an additional course elective. If you choose to take like an AP Human Geography, that will be your elective because the Western Civ is going to be a required course. So let's talk about the class schedule process. Here's how we decide what classes the students will have here. First of all, the teachers will recommend. The 8th grade teachers right now are looking how your students are doing, and they are going to do recommendations. They are actually in the process of doing that right now, and this is going to show up on the Hebron Hub, and I'm going to show you in a minute where that will show up here. Once the teachers have put out their recommendations, then I'm going to meet with the students in March to talk about what classes they might want to take, especially electives and things like that. Once we've looked at that, we're going to put it out for you as parents to see, and then you parents will approve the classes for the class schedule. So what do we look at when we're looking at class placement? Well, 4 things that we look at here. We look at PSAT scores. So if you were able to take the PSAT back in October, we're going to look at the scores and see where we think you should be placed based on how you scored. We'll also look at test grades from the previous year in that subject area. Teachers will look at how students are doing in the class right now and their work ethic and other things. And so then they'll put out their recommendation, and then that's what we'll use to kind of say this is where we think students should be next year as a 9th grader. Now, this is going to show up on the Hub, so let me show you kind of how that's going to show up on the Hub. To see the teacher recommendations, which again are not complete yet, but they're coming up, you would go to your student on the Hub, and then you would choose course requests. You can see it up there in the top. And then once you choose course requests, you'll see on the right-hand bottom right of the page, you'll see what the teachers have recommended in each of the subject areas. Okay? On the left-hand side, you'll also see what other courses are offered there. So this will be a way for you to kind of be able to view what students are recommended for and also what's offered there as well. Also, I'm just putting up here on the screen, just showing you the 4-year course plan. I'm going to be meeting with the students again in March, and they'll be able to see the recommendations, but they'll also be able to see the courses that we offer on this 4-year course plan. Let's move on to another section or another important thing about academics. GPA is a very important thing to know about and Hope Scholarship. So GPA stands for grade point average. And it can get a little confusing because there's different grade point averages. Hebron uses a 4.0 system. Each grade, an A, B, and C, has a numerical value. So an A represents a 4, a B represents a 3, a C represents a 2, a D represents a 1, and F represents a 0. So your GPA comes from taking those 4, 3s, 2s, and 1s, averaging them together to see what the GPA is. And that's collected every semester. Now, at Hebron, we use a weighted GPA. So we weight honors and accelerated classes by 0.5. So, for example, if someone makes an A in an honors class, instead of getting a 4 for the class, they'll get a 4.5 for the GPA. If they make a B, a 3.5, and so forth, okay? In dual enrollment classes, when those are eligible, those also are added a 0.5 to that as well. And then in advanced placement classes like AP Human Geography, we'll add a 4 point for that. So an A would be a 5, a B would be a 4, and so forth. We talk about three different types of GPAs. So first of all, we talk about the overall GPA. The overall GPA is the GPA for every single class that the student takes, including electives. So when we average all the 4s, 3s, and so forth together, whatever that comes out to be is their overall GPA. We also have what's called a core GPA. Now, the core GPA is only looking at your English, your math, your science, your social studies, and your foreign language. And we'll average those together to get a core GPA as well. I do want to mention the HOPE GPA because that's such an important thing for a lot of our families. First of all, HOPE GPA, eighth grade, is not included at all. But it is a totally different weighting than what Hebron does. HOPE GPA does not add any weights on honors classes or accelerated classes. On AP and dual enrollment classes, they'll add a 0.5, but only if it's a B or below, meaning they don't want any GPA to get above a 4. So if you make an A in an AP class, it will be a 4, but if you make a B in an AP class, they'll add the 0.5 and make it a 3.5. So no individual class goes above a 4, and so that's how the HOPE GPA is calculated. That's explained in the handout too, so I hope that will make sense to you. Also, HOPE GPA is not started till ninth grade, but you can see your HOPE GPA on a website called georgiafutures.org. So as students go into ninth grade, I'll be helping you create an account with gafutures.org, and then you'll be able to start seeing your HOPE GPA starting it after first semester of ninth grade here. I do want to mention this just because I have questions about this every year. There is what's called a HOPE Scholarship rigor requirement. And what this is HOPE Scholarship, to get the HOPE Scholarship, you have to have at least 4 rigorous classes by the time you graduate. Now, some people think that's only AP classes or that's only honors classes. It's really not that. Most students who graduate from here, almost all of them, will, by requirement, have at least 4 rigorous classes. Everyone usually takes pre-calculus. Everyone usually takes chemistry. Everyone usually takes physics. And everyone usually takes at least a second year of a foreign language. All of those are considered, those classes I just mentioned, are considered rigorous classes. So students from Hebron will graduate with enough rigorous classes. So I just don't want you to be worried when you see maybe not enough rigorous classes. They will get that from Hebron. Okay, I just want to mention a couple more things about HOPE. To get the HOPE Scholarship when you graduate from high school, you'll need at least a 3.0. And if a student has HOPE Scholarship and goes to a Georgia public college, it will pay for about 85% of the tuition from that college. If they go to a private college, it pays about $4,500 of the tuition as well. There is what's called Zell-Miller Scholarship. This requires the students to have a 3.7 HOPE GPA by the time they graduate, and at least a 1,200 on the SAT or a 26 on the ACT. But if they get that, then it will pay the full tuition in a public college in Georgia, and or in a private college, it will pay close to $5,000. I know I'm giving you a lot of information here. Number 4, let's talk about college planning and important tests. And you think, okay, I'm going into ninth grade, I'm already talking about college, but definitely it's important because college admissions offices pay really close attention to things like your grade point average. So that starts in ninth grade, so it's very, very important, and it's used very, very much by colleges. They also will be looking at your SAT scores and ACT scores. That's why we ask y'all to take the PSAT to prepare you for that. Many colleges will look at the rigor, and that will be like the AP classes and the honors classes and the dual enrollment classes. They'll look at your community service and your high school activities, like the sports and the clubs that you've been involved in. They'll look at recommendation letters from your teachers, and they will look at the essays that you've written. So all of these things as you're entering high school are going to be important. Let's talk about the important tests of high school, PSAT and pre-ACT. You've already experienced the PSAT probably this past October here, and this is why we give this to all of our students. We give it to our 8th graders, 9th graders, 10th graders, and 11th graders because we know it's such an important test to prepare for the SAT. In 10th grade, we'll be giving our students the pre-ACT, so that will give them experience preparing for the ACT as well. And then we encourage our students to start taking these SATs and ACTs usually junior year, just as they're getting ready to start applying to college. Some helpful websites I want to mention. Khan Academy is a very helpful website to help prepare you get better for the SAT. It's satpractice.org, but you can Google Khan Academy. It'll take you right there. There's also GA Futures, which I've already mentioned to you, has information about the Hope Scholarship. On the Hub, we have a website called Naviance. It's under Resources, and we encourage all of you to look there. It's under the Students Hub under Resources, and it will have information about college planning as well as has career assessments. It will have an interest test. It will have personality tests, all of those to help you determine good careers. And then lastly, I've got under the Group section of the Hub, the class of 2025, and this will have all kinds of information, anything from what should you be doing now as an eighth grader, to how does GPA work, just to explain that better, to the newsletters that we put out, including this one, to some practice for the PSAT, and to just other links to helpful websites. We'll also have the link to this video tonight. We'll have links to some websites about scholarships and things like that later on. I know we've given you a lot of material tonight. I've put my email up here, harry.robertson@hebronlines.org. If you have questions about any of these things, please feel free to email me. And again, we thank you for coming out tonight. We wish you a great evening. Thank you so much for coming. Have a good night.